Hi, I'm Dr. Brian, and welcome to another two-part Ask a Farrinarian series on metabolic diseases in horses. In part one, we'll go over the diseases themselves and hopefully clarify what it's meant when you hear terms like EMS, Cushing's, or PPID, because these terms can be confusing. In part two, we'll talk about how to diagnose these diseases, how to care for a metabolic horse, the special feeding, medications, what to watch for, and the complications of these diseases. So, why are these diseases important? Why should you care about metabolic disease in your horse? Why should you keep watching this video? As a vet and farrier, I encounter laminitis and founder a lot. And metabolic diseases are one of the most common causes of laminitis and founder in the horse, and can actually make these conditions even worse. Really, they are important to understand. In fact, once you're done watching this video, you can pop over and watch the previous two-part series on laminitis and founder either on our YouTube channel or on the blog page on the website. All right, one of the big reasons these diseases are so complicated is that they tend to involve both the metabolic system and the endocrine system, which regulates hormones in the body. These hormones play roles in just about every system in the body, so a disease in the endocrine system can alter a lot of other things in the horse. This complicated network is one of the biggest reasons why diagnosing and correction of metabolic diseases usually involves multiple tests and even repeated tests. Even as a veterinarian, I will admit this stuff can be complex. The two main diseases I'm going to talk about are Equine Metabolic Syndrome, or EMS, and PPID, Pituitary Pars Intermedia Dysfunction. But let's just shorten these to EMS and PPID. Later on, I'll touch on insulin resistance, but let's just start with the two biggies first. So, Equine Metabolic Syndrome, or EMS. This is sometimes called peripheral Cushing's. We're not gonna do that, it's confusing. Just either use the full name Equine Metabolic Syndrome, or EMS. Unfortunately, there's not a cut and dry definition for this condition. It's rather a grouping of symptoms. So the textbook definition for EMS is you have three traits: abnormal fat deposits, too much insulin production, more on that later, and are predisposed to laminitis. In reality, I'm worried that your horse may have EMS if it's too fat, has weird fat deposits in weird places, can't lose weight, and especially if it has sore feet. The classical presentation for EMS is a younger horse up to its teens. The horses that are predisposed to this condition are usually breeds selected for efficiency, like gated breeds, Arabs, ponies, or Mustangs. So why do these breeds get picked on so much? Well, the common thread among these types of horses is they were bred to endure lots of exercise and consume very little in the way of nutritious forage. Take ponies, for example, designed for pulling mine carts for hours and hours a day down where there is very limited hay. What about Arabs and Mustangs? They were built to cover vast distances every day, 50 to 60 miles, with minimal time for quality grazing. Even gated horses, long distances or pulling carts all day and not a lot of time to stop and graze. But nowadays we've switched that. We give our horses lots of rich food and very little exercise instead of what they're designed for, lots of exercise and running around and very little nutritious food. We've changed their lifestyle and diet much faster than their systems can adjust. So how does that manifest? A lot of times you have abnormal fat deposits up on the neck, the shoulders, and on the top of the rump. These guys tend to be easy keepers. You can't get them to lose weight. It's important to remember that while they tend to be obese, being fat doesn't necessarily mean they have a metabolic condition, and having a metabolic condition doesn't necessarily mean they're fat. This is one of the big reasons why diagnostic testing is so important. So on to pituitary pars intermedia dysfunction, or PPID. This is usually what people are talking about when they say Cushing's, but again, just stick with PPID for clarity. So what is PPID? It's essentially an excess production of steroid in the body called cortisol. And we all know common terms for steroids: cortisone, testosterone, estrogen. In this case, when I use the term steroid, I'm specifically referring to cortisol. So cortisol steroid regulates a bunch of stuff in your horse. It It's the main hormone produced when your body undergoes stress. And when the body has too much circulating cortisol, then everything's out of whack.
The classic presentation for a horse with PPID is an older horse that is abnormally hairy. So for example, it doesn't shed out in the summer, it just has too much hair or even a rough or curly coat, and it usually tends to look skinny. Importantly, these guys can actually look more like EMS horses in the early stages with abnormal fat deposits, but later on in the disease and more commonly, there is a loss of muscle mass that makes the horse look skinny. Again, this is why testing is important to distinguish between these two conditions because they can look similar initially.
So there are three organs primarily involved in this disease. The hypothalamus, which is located in the brain, regulates the pituitary gland located right next to it in the brain. The pituitary gland, in turn, regulates the adrenal glands, which is located near the kidneys. The adrenals then produce cortisol or steroid for the body. So back up to the top, the hypothalamus produces dopamine. When there's more dopamine production, there is less activity on the pituitary gland, which means less activity of the adrenal glands, which in turn means there's less steroid produced. So functionally, the dopamine acts like brakes in the car. By default, the brakes are on. Dopamine has a negative feedback to the pituitary gland. When the body needs more cortisol, the foot comes off the brake until the cortisol needs have been met, and then back on the brakes. In PPID, dopamine receptors aren't as responsive as they should be, so basically the brakes are out, which causes the pituitary gland to enlarge and produce too much ACTH, which then in turn produces too much steroid. And this excess of steroid is one of the main causes of our problems. So the medication we use in PPID increases the sensitivity to dopamine and essentially puts on new brake pads. Here's where we treat, here's where we test, here's the problem. So let me talk briefly about insulin resistance or hyperinsulinemia in horses. Just so we're all on the same page, I'm gonna go over what insulin does thanks to diabetes and Wilford Brimley. We all have some understanding that insulin regulates glucose. Keeping it simple, insulin plays a key role in tissue uptake and storage of glucose, which is the sugar that that tissue uses as a source of energy for later. Sometimes the horse's body becomes resistant to that activity of insulin, which means that when the body can't utilize insulin, it can't store and utilize glucose properly. This combination results in too much circulating glucose, which drives insulin up even more, and the cycle continues. The big challenge with horses and insulin is that they can't regulate their insulin levels like we can. They rely on diet and exercise to regulate and manage that glucose-insulin balance. A quick reminder, going back to EMS, insulin resistance is one of the biggest factors of this disease. Horses with PPID also do tend to struggle with insulin resistance as well. We'll get more into diets in part two, but for now, it's really important to remember that the key elements in insulin resistance are too much rich food and a lack of exercise.
Insulin is also important in fat metabolism and peripheral blood vessel dilation. So incorrect insulin levels and poor body response can mean poor blood pressure in extremities and is a big factor in laminitis. Additionally, hyperinsulinemia, too much insulin, decreases the quality of connective tissue and again increases the likelihood of laminitis.
That brings us to the end of part one. I hope you'll watch part two where we actually get to talk about diagnosing and taking care of these guys. Thanks for watching.